الله الرحمن الرحيم والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. Today we will continue the discussion that we started last week on verse number 101. And we said how in this verse Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala position for us the art, if you like, of magic in time and space. In fact, this is really the first time you see the mention of Babylon, okay, and the reign of two kings. Quran referred to them as Harut and Marut, who are basically, historical figures. They are not like imagined. Okay, the books of history talk about these two kings. Okay, and we said like around 40 centuries before Christ. 3,700 years before Christ, when Babylon was basically flourishing, and probably the first civilization that humanity knew about, deep, if you like, in history. And among the sciences or arts that flourished at the time was astronomy. And really, astronomy is among the earliest sciences, because human being has seen, the moon and the sun and the stars, and they want to understand this really world, okay, up above them. How do they really move, their positions, and basically their life is affected by that. So they want to understand that. And this is really the earlier, area that human beings really try to study and understand. But as we said last time, arts and sciences are evolving, at the beginning they may be attached and linked to myth, to things that are not really scientific as we basically know them today. And with astronomy, we found astrology. With chemistry, we found alchemy. Okay, you can see the and even with medicine, initially there were a lot of things related to magic. Okay, more than what we as humans really evolved, and these they show the progress in these different areas of study. You can see how the unscientific components, magic, myth, they start really to regress, okay? And until basically you purify basically these sciences. And even in our own life, we have seen in certain parts of the world, okay, how as, for example, in areas of medicine and other sciences, really people start to learn and become more educated. You can see this goes up, okay, through science, and all the other things, okay, that are related to myth and untrue things start really to regress, okay. As one goes up, the other really goes really down. And again, that tells you that in a way, the human being is always looking at a meaning, Okay. Now, if they don't have it in one way, they look at it in a different way. Whatever is available to them. And it seems that we have this tendency sometimes like to link ourselves to supernatural things to basically, again, try to understand things, okay, that things are that are really happening around us, okay, and in this situation we may fall into these fabricated really things, and the problem that Quran is trying to teach us is that the how to keep the economy of the human being, how to give the human mind, okay, the superiority over these really things, to keep these things under your control, not to allow your intellect and your faculties to become under the control of these things. You should be in charge. And this is very easy, okay, for the humans like to fall into that. Okay, the idea is how to the human beings retain their right position in this life, okay, and try to keep these things under their control, not to be controlled basically by them. And if we take in particular magic, and we said last time that at least Quran talked about three important features about magic. One of them is really like the how the those who are practicing magic, the magicians themselves, okay, feed on the weak points in the human being. And Quran said, like in the experience of Musa alayhi salam with the magicians of the Pharaoh, saharu a'yun an-nasi wastarhabuhum. So they basically tricked their eyes. They became really under the control of the magicians. Tarhabun, they feel the fear of them. So that is very important really feature. The second thing is that the magician also relies on the certain arts, okay, in order to understanding like the characteristics of things and material. Basically, some form of early chemistry, if you like, okay, and something that today we know, oh, this happens because of a chemical reaction. For them, it looked like
magic.
Is that right? Like, I mean, as if like there is a supernatural, or these magicians are connected with supernatural powers, and this is how they were able to bring basically this change. And Quran said, "Innama sana'u kaydu sahir." Sana'u. Sina'a is like an art. Okay, so this is the art of the magician. And they were able to use it, okay, to influence the people in front of them. The third feature, which is, I think, is very important, that the magicians rely on the rapid movement. This is the trickery. Is that right? Like, they have to do things very quickly to create that illusion. But in fact, it is not really true.
Yeah.
I mean, we know, and today, I mean, all of us have been to a circus where we see these magicians that they do. I mean, things that now, it has become a science by itself, how to do these things. But everybody knows that this is not, I mean, reality. But they are able, with this rapid movement, to give you the illusion. خُيِّلَ Quran used the term خُيِّلَ إِلَيْهِمْ مِنْ سِحْرِهِمْ أَنَّهَا تَسْعَى. So the people imagined that these sticks, when they throw them, the magicians, they look like snakes. But Quran is saying, khuyila ilayhim. The people who were witnessing that, they imagined. So it is an illusion. It's not totally true. But when Musa alayhi salam threw his stick and it became real snake and start eating all the other sticks, they realized that this is beyond trickery. That something that they felt that, oh, we are today witnessing something that is beyond trickery, beyond magic. And these magicians, I cannot understand their reaction until I have to say that they were looking and searching, okay, for something higher than magic. Because magic at the time of Musa alayhi salam was the highest, if you like, art that the people in that civilization were able really to reach. But when you realize something, you may become imprisoned in it. And at a time will come and say, is this it? Is this the end of history? Look today, when Fukuyama like talked about the end of history in the political arena, if you like, saying that liberal democracy is really the end of it, that there's nothing beyond that, and this is the end of history, and there we don't have to look for anything. And he himself retreated from that idea because he realized, and because of the reaction that he got from the people in his level as philosophers, I mean, that you are really captivating us in this thing. Oh, there is no limit. And we can see it from in the area of technology. I mean, you are closer to me than to these things, and you can see that what is stored for the future more than what is basically available today. Is that right? I mean, like, what may come in the future, much more than what we have seen so far. Is that right? So how come you're telling me that this is, as if I'm telling you, okay, what this version that we reached in computers is the end, there's nothing beyond it. What will happen? I mean, nobody will really think and search for, unless you believe in the unknown, that there is something, still lot of things stored for us, and we need to explore them. So these no question in my mind that these magicians were seeking something beyond. So the moment they saw what Musa alayhi salam did, they said, that's it. This is what we are looking for. Something that will liberate us from magic. What is this verse addressing? We said that the verse before it, it's telling us that the people, the followers of Musa alayhi salam, instead of sticking to the book, their own book, and instead of listening to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and they are the most familiar people with the revelation, they should be more trustworthy. Okay, and believing in Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, because and that was the argument of Quran all the time. قُلْ مَنْ أَنْزَلَ الْكِتَابَ الَّذِي جَاءَ بِهِ مُسْأَ. Why are you denying the revelation today? So who, I mean, how come that Musa alayhi salam brought to you the Torah? Who revealed the Torah on Musa alayhi salam? So if you are really, you really believe in Musa alayhi salam and the revelation that he received, you should not have big problem believing that there is really another revelation on another messenger like Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Instead of going in that direction to go to a higher level of understanding in terms of the revelation, they abandon the revelation altogether, however, what they had or what Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam brought to him, and they followed something much, much, much lower, which is magic. You see the regression?
Yeah.
That Quran is trying really to solve here, to treat, that there is tendency sometimes to regress. No, the idea how the human being continue going up to higher levels of understanding. What is magic in comparison to revelation? Revelation, as we said last time, that it does not take your role. It only guides you. This is the beauty of the revelation. And the moment you see that the revelation is taking your role, you become captive of even of religion. You remember every time I tell you we have to liberate ourselves even from religion. That is one way of liberating, when you assume your role. Nobody should take your role. Even the revelation should not take your role. It guides you. It shows you the way, but it will never. So if Quran tells us, فَكُّ رَقَبَةً, which means liberate the slave, we should be the first to abolish slavery. But Quran will not abolish slavery for you. You have to abolish it. You see where is the difference? Quran is telling, giving you the hint. Go and liberate. But Quran will not become like a government that, or a body that would really do this for you. You have to do it. You see, the same thing when we deal with the universe. How much the universe is generous. Very generous. But if you don't assume your role, you will not benefit from this universe. In fact, we may die if we don't move in this universe. Simple things we cannot meet. Like the need for food and water. If we don't move to bring them, we are done. Despite the fact that we live in a very generous universe. But the universe will not take your role. It again guides you how to move in this life. And the revelation will help guide you what direction you should give to your movement. Okay? Now, this is really huge. I mean, it will make a lot of difference. Is that right? Like when you just instill that idea in the next generation, that don't think that the universe or the revelation will take your role. You have to assume your role. But be guided by higher references. Don't follow the myth. Don't follow magic. Okay? Just because these are giving you an illusion. They are taking your role. It's very easy to be taken by it. But I want you to see the idea that I am talking about. So Quran is saying in the first three lines that instead of following the revelation, they followed sihr, which is magic that appeared also in the days of Sulaiman alayhi salam. And definitely, wrongfully, they ascribe magic to him. Quran is saying, no, it happened in the days of Sulaiman, but Sulaiman did not follow magic. وَاتَّبَعُوا مَا تَتْلُوا الشَّيَاطِينُ عَلَى مُلْكِ سُلَيْمَانِ. These are, Quran is referring to them as shayateen. They are human beings, but behaving like shaitan. Why? Because they are shaitan, in fact, it's called shaitan because we don't see shaitan. So these people also are working secretly. Okay? They are evil doers.
Were they people or were they jinns?
I'm sorry? No, humans.
They were human.
Humans.
Because everyone says they were jinns.
No. Because the Quran said, shayateen al-insi wal-jinn. There are shayateen, is clear in the among jinn. But Quran is emphasizing that also among the humans. What do you say at the end of Quran? Min al-jinnati wal-nas. These are the wrongdoers. Okay? Evildoers, not only from jinn, but also from the people, from humans. So they followed, but Quran is referring to them as shayateen because they are behaving like shayateen. During the reign of Sulaiman. But Sulaiman, Quran is saying, وَمَا كَفَرَ سُلَيْمَانَ وَلَكِنَّ الشَّيَاطِينَ كَفَرُوا يُعَلِّمُونَ النَّاسَ السِّحْرَ. And Quran referring to when sihr started. وَمَا أُنزِلَ عَلَى الْمَلَكَيْنِ بِبَابِلَ هَارُوتَ وَمَارُوتَ. You see, but Harut and Marut, Quran is referring to them as kings. But Quran, very beautiful, did not say Malik.
Here it says angels.
Yes, did not say Malik, said Malak. So these are human beings, but they have angelic features. They are good, like the angels. The same way, yeah. Quran used shayateen for the wrongdoers and used Malak for these very good kings at their time. So during their reign, you see, during their reign, magic flourished to the point that it caused disturbance in the whole city, in the whole area. And Quran said, and I think that caused a lot of confusion to even commentators, because Quran is saying, وَمَا يُعَلِّمَانِ مِنْ أَحَدٍ حَتَّى يَقُولَا إِنَّمَا نَحْنُ فِتْنَةٌ. If they are good people having angelic features, how come they say about themselves they are fitna? No, they are telling them, we are living in a fitna. We are living in a time of disturbance that affected every one of us. It's overwhelming. Give you an example. If I want to describe someone, okay, as fair, just, I say, this person is just. But if I want to show that this guy, his justice is unbelievable, I will say, he is justice. What do they call the judges here? Justice. That he embodies justice. So in Arabic, the same way, we use the infinite as adjective. You see? So you, instead of saying you are fair, I say you are the fairness itself. You are the justice itself. The same way here, instead of saying we are living a disturbance, they said, we are all in the disturbance. We are like drowning in the disturbance. So be aware. They learned magic, not to practice it, but to know about it and warn the people about its ill effects.
In fact, nahnu fitna, we are.
We are living in it. Instead of saying we are disturbed, we are the disturbance. Not they are themselves, but we live in that disturbance that overwhelmed everybody to show how big is that problem. So in other words, the whole society was taken by sihr. Remember a similar situation when Musa alayhi salam left his people to receive the tablets. What did they do? They followed another sahir, but the Samiri who brought the calf, okay? He basically applied some form of magic. He made it a hollow body, so the air will go from one place to another, creating a sound. So they thought that this is the sound made by the calf. You see, this is it for them. They don't understand it. Okay, they thought that he has supernatural power. Okay, so I have to believe in that. This is very tangible. Why to believe in something that I don't see? Musa is telling me to believe in a God that I don't see. You see where is the problem? So they regressed. And Quran is telling us that regression occurred again. That regression occurred again. And what was their advice? That we are living in that disturbance. فَلَا تَكْفُرْ. What did we say about kufr? What does it really mean? Covering up. What magic is doing? Covering up. You see the connection? So Quran is very delicate in using these words. Okay? So be aware. We are living in a very big disturbance. Yes, these you can be easily taken by the powers of these magicians, because it gives you that illusion, but you lose your own control. And you that may lead you to the cover up, to the kufr itself, in that meaning, okay, in the original meaning of.
That makes sense, because you lose trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as soon as you believe that something.
Exactly. What exactly? What does it mean to not to believe in Allah, or to cover up that the idea of God? You are covering all His attributes.
It changes all of
you. Oh, that's different. And this word Quran said, you reached a dead end.
The cause of it.
You hit the wall, which is death. You are not living anymore. قُتِلَ الْإِنسَانُ مَا أَكْفَرَ. Oh, it's very scary. That I mean, that this is the saga of the human being. This is why we always say that kufr is not like something happening outside. Kufr is a disease. No one is immune to it. You have to protect yourself against it. Not, I mean, to go outside and say, oh, you are kafir and I am mu'min, I have Quran, I am better than you. Anyone has the potential. We have to be very careful, very vigilant to protect ourselves. Taqwa, you remember? Keep always that in mind. How to protect yourself from what? From kufr, from fusuq, from asyan, from nifaq. All these problems that the surah is talking about. And you have to protect yourself from sihr. The same way you protect your mind by avoiding alcohol, also at the intellectual level, you have also to protect your mind from things that may corrupt the human intellect.
What's the word sihr actually mean then?
Magic.
That's what
sihr is. Yes, sorcery or something like that, trickery. But you see, Quran, I want you to go beyond the actual act, okay? Because Quran is highly symbolic. We said today, sihr may take a different form. The media, for example. Because when they are covering up, they are practicing sihr. Is that right? And economy. What did they, the people that were responsible for the meltdown, they were putting the people in illusions. You know it. Is that right? It's a form of magic. Okay, you will. They gave you the illusion that you will become rich in very short period of time, and few people took advantage of it, and the rest were basically deceived. So the deception can be practiced anywhere, and medicine can be practiced. How many people were basically? I mean, we heard about them. They were caught in fraud because they basically deceived the people. They may do things that are not indicated. And what if you tell the patient you need this, how does that poor guy know if this is really true or not? But if you don't really have conscience and compassion and thinking about, he is not paying the insurance. Will pay. I mean, this is nonsense. You see, it's nonsense because it's another form of deception.
And people are looking for something, like you were saying that people are looking for something, but they're at their weakest point.
Mm-hmm.
That's why, you know, exactly. People who look for like miracles and you know, medicine, they have tried everything else, right?
Yes.
So they believe in whatever, in the amulet or somebody's giving them, they believe in that that's causing them to feel better. So they're looking for this, that's the point, like the weakest form.
And that's very, I mean, I thank you very much, Shakir, because really this is very important, because Quran is not just sharing with us a historical event. This is really the beauty of it. And remember we said in the past that Quran has philosophy of history that is hidden, that we need to uncover it. Okay?
So you had a philosophy of history.
Philosophy of history. It's not only talking about the external event or the event from outside. But the Quran,
Quran, hidden meaning.
Exactly.
Like the Bible, which has more stories.
That's fine. But the idea,
But
the idea is really to go deeper and ask the question: how these things happen and why?
But this is harder.
No question about
it.
Exactly. You can read. I mean, all these historical accounts. And just for fun, but you don't really ask the real question, why these events happen, and how they happen, and what are the laws that govern the change of these events. Because what is history? It's really history. These events that really talk about the human association, how people relate to each other. Otherwise, there is no history. If there is no association, there is no history. Okay, so the idea is not only to tell us that magic appeared in that area and the flourished, and but what really, how that impacted really the people, and this is how the Harut and Marut, these are the good people who realized the problem, and they started really. Warning their people. Don't be taken by them. This is a cover up. فَلَا تَكْفُرْ. Don't follow the cover up. Okay, this is an illusion. Use your mind. You are higher than this. You are bigger than this. If you don't mind, let me just answer my. This call, I'll be back.
You need a phone?
I need a phone. Yeah. I realized that it's left. So I want also to share with you another similar problem, okay, that one can learn from that experience. How people, again, may regress from higher levels of reference, okay, to guide them in life to something that it gives them the illusion that they are connected with some supernatural powers and they lose control and they are taken by these really things. Myth. You are familiar. Every culture has its own myth. However, but the one that is became really very proliferative, if you like, is the Greek mythology. Okay, and you can see even big figures, like historians or like let us say Arlong Toynbee or others, they used the mythology to confirm certain ideas or and again in the absence of a higher reference, okay, so they may go to something that is available to them, okay, and they may use it, as we said, like, okay, if they are talking about any historical, trying to understand certain historical accounts, they may use these, the mythology everybody knows, even the people who use it, they know that it's not really true, okay, but they use it but under their control. What is really disturbing when someone has a higher reference, like the Muslims, they have Quran, they leave Quran and follow the myth. And we see in our literature, there are a lot of things that we know they really are mythical, they are not true. But they ascribe them to religion, I mean, because of repetition over and over, I mean, and they, oh, this is a doctor, and unfortunately, they cannot ascribe it to Quran. To whom they ascribe it? To Muhammad sallallahu alaihi
wasallam.
Yeah. Hadith.
To Hadith. And this is why there are a lot of things that we say, oh, this is not an authentic Hadith. This is myth. This is really fabricated. Okay, but you see how this is a sign of losing control. If you put it or measure it against really a higher reference like Quran, it will immediately show that it is not really true. But when we abandon Quran, not as a book, we abandon it in the way we are as a reference, as the ultimate reference. Because it is nobody can really question the authenticity of Quran. You see what I mean? And alhamdulillah, it was preserved by the divine. It was not left to us to protect it. That is really a big plus, that it has been protected for us. Even if there are, I mean, ones who tried really like to change it or corrupt it, or alhamdulillah, that doesn't really happen. Otherwise, you cannot use it as the ultimate reference. You see what I mean? But the problem is when we regress and follow the myth and leave the authentic really reference. That is really the problem. I would say that we have to very, very, very careful about it. Now, one word about myth. Yes, we are saying that it is not true, but really the myth, even the things that are untrue, they may have some value. What is the value then of the myth? Because really the myth represent what the people like to see. You see, they fabricated something, but it is a reflection of their own aspirations, what they like to see. Okay, what are really their hopes? What are their needs? Okay, so they put it in the form of a fabricated story, a fiction. Okay, so even today when you read a fiction, okay, it has a value. Although it is not a true story, but you can, it can tell you why that individual used his or her imagination to bring us a story of that sort. You see what I mean? So myth is not totally, although we know it is not true, but also it can tell me about the society.
Does. Our first assignment when we're assessing people is we look at rules, myths, and beliefs.
Uh-huh.
What are the rules that guide you? What are the myths that inform the rules?
Uh-huh.
And what are the beliefs that you've been informed from that?
Very
and
good.
How then that is how you live your
exactly.
life.
Exactly.
So if you think that all women, you know, do whatever, that's how you operate in your life.
Exactly.
If
exactly.
all children are noisy, you see a child, you hear noise. Like
uh-huh.
you want them to
uh-huh.
shut up
uh-huh.
as opposed to ask questions.
Yes.
Like, so it's just, that's our first assignment.
Yes, very beautiful. Yeah, you see, I mean, but you are using it under your control. You are not like giving that myth.
You become conscious of it.
Of
you're
it?
Talking about your
exactly.
unconscious way of
you are not
it.
Letting the myth to lead your life.
Which is what happens.
You see what I mean? That is the idea that would help us to know how to use them. As long as you are using it under your control, that's fine. But to become taken by it, okay, losing your role, using your essential differentia, which is our
consciousness,
intellect. Okay.
You are talking about the receiving end.
Receiving end. You see, I have no problem, okay, to read about a myth. Okay. In fact, there is this anthropologist who died just a few years ago in France. His name is Claude Levin-Strauss. I mean, he died at the age of like 100 years. He's very, very respectful, and his area of interest. Okay. In fact, this guy was able to show, because he lived with primitive societies, like in the Amazon and elsewhere, and he was capable of showing that every society, every human association, no matter how primitive it is, okay, it is complex. It is very complex. So, and they have culture. They may be different from the culture like of the Western Europe or United States or Southeast Asia or China or whatever, but they have their own culture, because in the past they say, oh, these are primitive, they don't. No. He proved that, and not only that, but their culture is as complex as others, but in a different way. You see what I mean? So he also studied myth. The interesting thing about what he said about myth is that it fosters binary thinking. Either this or that. Zero or one.
We call it black or white.
Black or white. This is the problem with the myth, he is saying. As humans progress and advance, they start to see the multitude possibilities between the zero and one.
The shades of gray.
You see, this is very, you see the beauty of it? Okay, so that is the problem of, if you like, of, or at least if you are aware of it, then you know, okay, to that level it can help me. Beyond that, I need to look for something of higher level.
It's maladaptive when we look at people with black and white.
Can you raise your voice a little bit?
We say when we look at people and we're assessing their, if they are in black and white thinking, we say they're maladaptive. It's like it's a psychosis in a way, because they can't see, they're not coachable, so they're not going to grow. They're stuck in
that
their
level.
Static
oh,
state.
Oh, very good. Yes,
so
they become captive to that level and they cannot move.
So
yes.
We see them as people who are going.
And this is the problem. فَلَا تَكْفُرْ. Don't become like. Die in that level. You see, you have to liberate yourself all the time. And this is what we said about the beauty of Quran. Just from its name, Quran, its multitude of readings. Qara'a, to read. Quran is multitude of readings. To the point that Quran describes itself, that if you bring the whole ocean and make out of it ink and write the meanings, the words of Allah as signified as meanings, the ink will dry up and the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not end or perish. What does that really mean? So you have to look into newer meanings all the time. If you stay static at one level of understanding, you die. You perish.
Can you say something?
Yes, please.
The other day I was listening to and exactly what you are saying, and it applies to the Quran. It applies to Allah, who al awwal, who al akhir, who al zahir, who al batin. The same thing applied to Quran, who al awwal, who al akhir, who al zahir, who al batin. Zahir is what we are reading. Batin is the one which everybody has to try to take it out from.
How to dig deeper and deeper, exactly.
And multi, you know, the one you are saying that it has too many meanings. I mean, it's unlimited.
Yeah, but again, in order, this is what I have been saying over and over, that in order to explore these new meanings, you need to ask different questions.
It's Carol Dweck's work, Growth Mindset. That we're going to be reading.
I'm sorry?
Carol Dweck's work that we were saying, Growth Mindset.
Uh-huh.
So she has a whole picture about growth mindset, and I can't remember what the other one is.
Fixed mindset.
Yes, exactly.
That's
exactly.
The black and white thing.
Yes.
The
exactly.
The fixed mindset.
The fixed mindset is static, it leaves you at one level, and basically, as we said, you realize that level. This means that you become imprisoned in it. You die in it. You see? So the idea is how to really liberate yourself from it, okay, in order to reach really a higher. But again, unless you ask a question at a higher level of understanding, Quran will not give you a new meaning. And in order to do that, in order to state a new question at a higher level of understanding, see how much sciences you need, how much knowledge you need to acquire in order to ask a higher question. Take any researcher. Okay, how they are, they sit like this and they get a revelation about a new question. You have to do something. Yes, I believe that it is really a form of revelation, but you need to work for it in order to get it. So how they get it? They study. And the more they get the information,
the more they know they don't know anything.
Exactly. Then they start asking newer questions. So they extend their hand into the unknown and make it possible. All these are still possibilities. They are in the potential. They are still in the unknown. But believe me, the unknown is more than what we have known so far.
And the universe is a good example.
Yes.
Like I said, we're dots in the Milky Way.
Yes.
Like literally,
exactly.
Dots in the Milky Way.
Yes.
That's one of the galaxies that we know that exists.
وَإِنَّا لَمُوسِعُونَ. It is always expanding.
That's what I'm saying. We're like,
yeah,
literally.
Yeah, Quran said it very clearly. وَإِنَّا لَمُوسِعُونَ. We created this universe and it is continuously expanding. So there is no end of history. you can come to that conclusion very easily. That
history
there is no
story. Like, yeah. There's no end to his story.
Yeah.
It's his story. I'm just saying there's no end to his story.
Very good.
This is just
yeah.
I got another
Yes,
the ayah before that 101. ولما جاءهم رسول من عند الله مصدق لما معهم نبذ فريق من الذين أوتوا الكتاب كتاب الله وراء ظهورهم كأنهم لا يعلمون. Allah is talking about the people at that time. They knew. They did not do out of ignorance. They just put it like aside, like we don't know anything about it.
As if they don't know.
Exactly, but they knew it.
Yes, no question, knowingly they don't know.
Next ayah is about
وَاتَّبَعُوا. So they are conscious.
Right.
And the following verse, وَاتَّبَعُوا مَا تَتْلُوا الشَّيَاطِينَ. So they, instead of clinging to the highest level of reference they have,
right. I'm thinking
which is revelation, however in the form of Torah or the form of the new book,
right.
Quran,
right.
Okay, so they abandoned it, put it behind their backs,
right.
And followed, they regressed into something of lower value.
I'm thinking different, maybe I'm wrong, but the people, the first ayah is about the people who really knew what Quran is, what Torah is, and they exactly knew. They just, not out of ignorance, they knew, they just put it aside like they didn't know.
Mm-hmm.
The second ayah, what we are talking about, the seher, and those are the people who are naive, they are just...
No, the naive people are the ones who were taken by it.
By it.
You see what I mean? The masses.
Right.
But the ones who really are practicing the magic itself, they want to control people.
And those are the people who...
Yes! These are the ones that they, instead of following the guided by the highest reference they had, they followed something of lower value. What is, they have their own agenda.
That's exactly how civilization developed. If you look at entertainment, the Romans, the Sophists,
yeah.
There was a few group of people who were guiding everything, and they created the Colosseums and the theaters, so the masses were being entertained.
And taken by this is why the Harut and Marut were really warning the people. This is a huge disturbance. It's a chaotic situation. Anyone can be taken by that. So they have to warn them, فَلَا تَكْفُرْ. Be aware. let us see what where are the effects. فيتعلمون منهما ما يفرقون به بين المرء وزوجه. Instead of seeing the problem, they learning from it its ill effects, to the point that it will dissociate between spouses, to cause really to disrupt the fabric. If you disrupt the family, you disrupt the fabric of the whole society. If you destroy that unit, you destroy really the whole society. This is how people come together. Okay, so instead of bringing people together, this will divide them. يفرقون به بين المرء وزوجه. So that, again, as we said earlier, that Quran is not only sharing with us a social phenomenon.
It's a strategy. Divide and conquer
is
a very common political strategy.
Exactly, and that's really the problem that Quran is, again, what we need to protect ourselves, how we need to protect ourselves, how to protect the society from going into a problem like that, causing a lot of tumult and disturbance, okay? And at the same time, وَمَا هُمْ بِضَارِّينَ مِنْ أَحَدٍ إِلَّا بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ. Nothing happens without the permission. But again, you have to make the change. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is permitting this to happen because you chose. You have chosen this path. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not change it for us unless we initiate the change. You see what? Back to the idea of autonomy, back to the idea that the revelation will not take your role, will not play your role. You have to assume your role. You have to be the agent of change. وَيَتَعَلَّمُونَ مَا يَضُرُّهُمْ وَلَا يَنْفَعُهُمْ. So the whole thing, there is no benefit of it. Everything is in the direction of evil doing, of harm. Quran put it in both ways. It's causing harm and no benefit, because sometimes you may benefit a little bit and there may be some, but the harm is more than. Here it's saying, no. When Quran talked about alcohol, he said, and there is something good and something bad about it. But the bad is more than, the risk is more than the benefit. It's very beautiful. Here, it's saying there is no benefit whatsoever. Zero benefit, more harm. وَيَتَعَلَّمُونَ مَا يَضُرُّهُمْ وَلَا يَنْفَعُهُمْ. مَا يَضُرُّهُمْ, what harm them. وَلَا يَنْفَعُهُمْ, nothing, no benefit is coming out of it. Okay? وَلَقَدْ عَلِمُوا. This is very beautiful clause. وَلَقَدْ عَلِمُوا لَمَنِ اشْتَرَاهُ. When you say اشْتَرَى, mean like to buy something. Okay? So as if Quran is saying, those who follow the witchcraft or magic or something like that, okay, they as if they are sold, they have sold their souls to it. You see the idea of to become under the control of it. So Quran is saying, those who really followed this, they sold their own souls, their own lives. They lost control. And those will not have any compensation in the hereafter. We saw that they will not benefit anything from it here. Quran went further that the consequence, when you see akhirah, is the consequence. However it is here, the immediate consequence, or the, on the long run, in the akhirah per se, in the day of judgment, in the next life, also there will be no. وَلَقَدْ عَلِمُوا لَمَنِ اشْتَرَاهُ مَا لَهُ فِي الْآخِرَةِ مِنْ خَلَاقٍ. There will be no reward for that. وَلَبِئْسَ مَا شَرَوْ بِهِ أَنفُسَهُمْ. Vile to what they have really sold themselves. They bought, if you like, witchcraft or magic and sold themselves. What type of transaction is this? You see that? لَوْ كَانُوا يَعْلَمُ.
We call it a dirty deal.
Dirty deal, exactly.
We call it a dirty deal.
Very beautiful.
Give yourself.
لَوْ كَانُوا يَعْلَمُوا. If they only knew about it. But the next verse, and inshallah we'll stop there. وَلَوْ أَنَّهُمْ آمَنُوا وَاتَّقَوْا. Believe. But believe in what? If they really believe in themselves, if they believe that this magic is causing them harm, they destroying their society, causing disturbance, the tumult, and if they believe, not only believe, but they protected themselves, they practice taqwa. So you remember what we said about muttaqeen? Harut and Marut were playing that role. Harut and Marut were playing that role, okay, the role of the muttaqeen, this layer in the society that will warn the people about outcomes. They warn the people about consequences. So and we need to assume that role in the society. You see, I mean, the same way we have centers to monitor the weather and when a hurricane is coming and when a storm is, you see how you can save lives this way. If you know what is coming, people take precautions and people move from one place to another, evacuate and all the, you see how many lives will be saved? Why don't we have monitors at the social level to warn the people what is coming? There is a problem in the society. Oh, there is something coming. Okay, something happened in another probably society and we are not immune to it. How can we protect ourselves? How can we protect our children?
Isn't that what the religious institutions are supposed to be doing?
That is the idea. That how supposedly, you see, if we understand the idea of taqwa in this fashion, taqwa, till now, it is presented as an individual thing. Okay, like to have the fear of Allah, be conscious of, that's fine, I have no problem about that. But how we can transform this idea, okay, to practice at the level of the society. And to have this layer in the society, layer of al-muttaqi, who really are vigilant about what is happening, monitoring what is happening and warning the people and advising them, assisting them what they need to do in order. And this is why you always see in Quran, khafu. If you are afraid of something happening, before it happened, you need to take action. We see that all the time in Quran.
Foresight.
So you have to be proactive, rather than waiting until the problem happens and it will be sometimes too difficult.
It's a higher level of being.
Conscious, yes. And this is how you can see the connection with the first section of the surah. هُدًى لِلْمُتَّقِي. And Quran is saying it, وَلَوْ أَنَّهُمْ آمَنُوا وَاتَّقَوْا لَمَثُوبَةٌ مِّنْ عِنْدِ اللَّهِ خَيْرٌ. They will have a better reward from Allah, better outcome. لَوْ كَانُوا يَعْلَمُ. Again, you need knowledge. You need to learn about these things. Doesn't happen haphazardly. And today I always say that you need to integrate several sciences together in order to help you solve a problem. It's becoming very complicated. You see, the level of knowledge, the level of experience needed is much, much higher than when we, our societies were not that advanced, or they were really like, I mean, primitive or of low level of culture. But as culture becomes really more complicated and reaches higher levels, so you need more sciences now. The problems also are complicated, and you need this integration of sciences and experiences and this interprofessional approach, honestly, interprofessional approach to solve problems. Still, we are individualistic. But let me leave you with this idea. The more you specialize, the more you specialize, it may look individualized. Is that right? Because you become like you are the only one who knows about the intricacies of a certain like science. But believe me, that will bring people closer to each other. Because you feel that you are deficient in so many areas and you need the help from all the people in these different areas. So it may sound paradoxical. The more you specialize, the more you need the other. The more that will bring. So the vision of labor bring people together. You see, very beautiful. And so we move from being independent to become interdependent. And we need this a lot as a form of taqwa. If we really want to exercise taqwa at the social level, I need the experience of all the people around me.
Well, that's the definition of ummah.
Oh, exactly. Mm-hmm. Exactly. In fact, ummah is really the association of people who have a common goal. From the word amma, which means that you basically have a destination and you are going towards that destination.
And it is interesting, both the ayahs are ending with
لَوْ كَانُوا يَعْلَمُونَ.
Yeah. What is the wisdom you think about?
Because as we said, you need the knowledge.
Yeah, he could say, you should know.
Uh-huh.
He said,
yeah,
like if you knew about
it. But it's a process. So if you come to the concept, if you come to the space in yourself where like you believe in Allah, then you believe in every process that's created to get there. And you've said this is the truth versus discovering the truth. There's so much more. You're grounded in that. Nobody can shake you from it once you've gone through a process.
Yeah,
and so I think Allah is like creating a path.
But this is beautiful. The word law here is really in, it contains or it connotes, okay, the to inspire you and encourage you, urge you to learn more, to know more.
That's
because it doesn't happen with ignorance.
Also, I'm thinking, you know, and I mean, I really, Allah is giving you a chance and giving you a fair ground. It's like now he's not dictating you should do this, you should do that. He's giving you a fair ground.
Guidance. You have to play your role. Okay? There is something called magic. Okay? We are not covering up. It is there. Okay? And then we know how people, this has been practiced before and can be practiced in different ways. But be aware. Okay? I am giving you a higher reference that will guide you. You don't really need this illusion of connection with superpowers and something to control others. Okay? So be aware of it. You can really follow. You have the revelation that will help you to sort out what is really good, what is really bad.
One thing I noticed, like recently, I think I'm seeing that the magic is coming back
In different forms,
Even in the form of the illusions, like people are believing black magic and all this stuff. I'm seeing a lot more, and I'm from Pakistan and India. I've seen a lot of people believe that.
Yes,
and I think because of the weakness, they have the Quran.
Yes.
So they're looking for answers somewhere else. They cannot figure out what is the answer. What is
this problem? Easier.
Easier to.
Yeah. Okay. Oh, I mean, why I have to learn and go to school and to college search. Okay, for the truth and knowledge and all these things. No, this is easy.
How do you deal with people like that? How do you help them when they're not willing to want to
education
for working?
Yeah,
this, and if they're people that do this are primarily uneducated individuals. That's it.
That's the problem. I've seen like the people who are calling themselves doctors and scholars. They're kind of teaching that too.
They're actually encouraging that behavior. So how do we change? How do we make that?
Very, very good. You see, one thing when you read Quran, Quran summarize for you, okay, a whole era in a few words. Okay, and sometimes when you read these few words, and we think that the problem was solved very quickly. You see, that gives that, but it is an illusion. It's not the truth. These things take time. Quran is saying, وَمَا يُعَلِّمَانِ. Yeah, which means that this is education. It's not just informing. There is difference between giving you the information and educating. That is a different process. It is a process.
Step by step.
Step by step. But we, with a clear objective. This is why today, if you want to teach something, the first thing they tell you, have you shared with your students what are the objectives of your course and all the, what does that really mean? What are the goals? Where are you taking us? Okay, so I think we need, I should really call it pedagogy. It's more than education. It's deeper type of education that takes into consideration not only information, but changing behavior, which means taking people through experiences. They have to see the value of something through experience, not. And this is what I'm trying to say, that Quran, see how Quran shares with us these previous experiences, okay? And sometimes Quran captures them for us. It's very difficult to know who is Harut and Marut. And I mean, if it were not really for this verse, I probably did not really go and search. I mean, who are these people? What happened to the study of astronomy? How was, connected with astrology and magic and witchcraft and all these things. So, you see, I mean, it is really a deeper approach to the problem. Okay, not just relaying information here and there without really a clear, really objective, and without the practice. You see, most unfortunately of our education has become totally narrative. Just listening, not even interacting with asking the why, the critical questions.
The problem with us, from a psychological, you have a desire, just like you want to eat, to know God. Uh-huh. And so now I'm getting what you're saying when Allah says, your heart finds rest when you know Him, but there's a process to know Him. And so when you have this void education, that's why we're stuck in drugs and addictions and TV and relationships, because we're not fulfilled. And
yes.
Human beings are searching to be fulfilled.
Yes, yes.
And
exactly.
It's only like you're saying, like,
this
is
why it's very beautiful. Because
they
is,
need it. It's right. not even
and
just
this
like,
is the only way I can explain the belief, how the magicians in the days of the Pharaoh, they made sujood.
Right.
The moment they saw. Nobody will do an action like that unless that individual was searching. You see, I mean, they were not satisfied with what they had. They mastered it, but they found themselves become slaves to what they have realized.
They thought they were it. There's nothing better.
But when they saw there is something higher, immediately they
Life will set you free.
Yes, exactly. They saw their freedom. And really the sujood is really the manifestation, or really like the way they manifested their freedom. Because you see, you are, what does it mean when you put your forehead on the ground? You are liberating yourself from yourself, which is the strongest prison one may face in life. More than the prison of society, more than the prison of history, more than any other prison. If you are able to liberate yourself from your own ego, this is the highest level of freedom. And this is why Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, when you are there, you are the closest to Allah. You are free.
And when you are there, are you open to receive?
You see?
You don't get it unless you're open.
But Quran still said, don't stop there. Make sujood, but then make more sujood. Iqtarib. Fasjud, waqtarib. The first surah. Fasjud, this is how it ends. You remember? Iqra' bismi rabbika alladhi khalaq. It ends like this. Wasjud, waqtarib. Yes, this is a very high level close to Allah, but there is also more closer levels. Move, continue the movement. That is the beauty of it. And this is why in our prayer, this is the only thing that we do twice. Again, very symbolic to remember that you have not reached, you have to do it again. Okay? All right. Jazakallah khair. Thank you very much.
I can't do it.